certain ideas around like code switching as it relates to the performativity of black masculinity, or how like black male bodies, or like people that are perceived to be male bodies as like being required to live up to an unfair standard of masculinity, which, you know, hits hard if you're part of, you know, the gender and or sexual diversity. And so there's like very much that internal dialogue, like that dialogue expressed through Ronnie's dancing and choreography.
Because Ronnie's switching with two different personalities, because Ronnie is playing this twin god. So one of the personalities is, like you say, almost like a Jean-Paul Gaultier sort of like alone on the femme side, and then like that over masculinized sort of character, Tom Finn, like other characters. That kind of
thing. Approximately, I mean, the essence with Ronnie is that, yeah, it very much gives split personality. So one performs a style that would that is best described as like faux femme, and the other side performs real
faux femme
and realness, and it's like those are two like, you know, standard categories in ballroom, which we realness standing for like summoning gay men to walk on the runway and kind of like perform cis heterosexuality in the most convincing way.
Like the American category also.
Well, it is.
Like, it is the American category.
So okay. Like realness, and then there's the faux femme side. So, and it's funny, like we were, Ronnie and I were having that conversation, you know, when I was trying to explain, you know, that character that I thought of me, moving into faux femme, he was like, oh, right, it's like when you do something feminine, like you're caught voguing in your bedroom, like your father walks in on you while like you vogue, when it's like initially not necessarily something you're comfortable doing in front of your parents.
So there's this continual switching, and it's kind of interesting because you talk about this performance of like over-sexualization of the male body, and do you see a kind of like a reconciliation? And is it supposed to appear as like this like schizophrenic like moving back and forth, or is the objective to show that it's fluid?
I mean, I think that you know, endings can be positive, negative. Sometimes the outcome is neutral, and I don't necessarily want to give out like
everything.
Yeah. You know, because y'all are gonna have to come see the show. But yeah, essentially that's what we explore, and it does come to a conclusion for the spirit of Marasa. Mm. Yeah.
Now again, we don't want to give everything away, but I think it is important to get into Siren a bit. Because we're talking a little bit about the whole issue of transgenderism and the metaphor of transgenderism. You've spoken in your own mission practice about your transition or transitioning as almost being one of your best art projects, which I agree with. How can we talk about that? I find it interesting that, you know, it's part of this story right here, and this idea of, yeah, this transitioning as an art.
Yeah, I mean, I still feel the same way about it. I put so much love and you know, art, like, yeah, artistic, you know, touch in my, you know, transition, so I don't know what else to say about that, but it was important for me to explore the theme of, or I don't know if it was so much important for me to explore the theme of transsexuality as it kind of like coming organically. Sayana told me that she wanted to play the role of the siren. And I was looking for a way to tie all the dolls, like all the acts and all the characters to each other, so that there can be more of a narrative arc than past iterations of Ayu Bobo. Mm-hmm. And for the siren, I thought of, of course, the Hans Christian Andersen tale, which to me, and I think it's a known thing that it rings as a transgender metaphor. The mermaid forsakes her vocal ability in order to gain legs. And so her legs could be analogous. I mean, we don't have to get into specifics, but basically she forsakes her voice to have legs in order for her relationship with her sailor prince guy to be palatable and socially acceptable. But then she realizes that even after having forsaken her voice in order to have legs, the relationship has still has a number of dysfunctional components. And so it's sort of going, broadly speaking, going from the idea inversely of the representation of black bodies, more specifically black female bodies, and how it could lead one to disillusionment, to Marasa, which is a take on code switching and unfair standards of masculinity as it pertains to black men and also black male bodies or gender non-conforming people, to Cyana, which has to do with transness, more specifically, as it relates to romantic love or connectedness, with men. I mean, that's what most of my experience has been, and I can imagine that navigating. I don't know how it is for trans women to strictly navigate lesbian spaces, but men are known to. Men are expected to abide by expectations with regards to their sexuality to a point that makes them seem less free than women. I think that might be why from what I've heard and experienced, it seems harder for cisgender men, unless they're gay, to feel affirmed in a relationship with a trans woman. # toxic masculinity. I mean, do we even say that still? But yeah, masculinity.
# white industrial or whatever. Complex.
yeah. The spectacle certainly informs the way we frame our identities around sexuality, and it doesn't just when you think of a spectacle, it doesn't just affect you personally, but it also affects the people around you who consume the same. Spectacular products. And so, one might think of the fact that, the black family is partly responsible for fostering, and not just the black family, it's something that affects all men in the world. It informs a way of thinking that conditions men to feel they can't be gay or they can't be too feminine, because it's seen as lowering your ranking, or # misogyny.
# Darwin, Charles Darwin. And it's interesting because one of the words I've recently heard is this word called corpsing. And it comes from the theater. And apparently what it means is when you're on stage or in a movie set, and you actually break out of character and actually start laughing at what we've done. And it seems like just that is an offense to the sort of like the spectacle, right? So even like myself, you
what's
know, web
corp. So okay, that was it. I don't know what corp.
Yeah, so it's like almost like that. It's that moment where when you're on camera and you break character, right? And it's that feeling of breaking character because the camera is asking you to be that. And that's what you're being paid to do. So that moment where you break character and then you actually start laughing at it also, it's this corpsing moment. It's a moment of like the dropping, the death of that role, of that framing.
Absolutely. And it's hard. It's hard to keep that stance because we're all part of the same spectacle. And so, you know, there is so much that can be said about like, you know, being like being free-spirited and like being oblivious to like, you know, what other people think, but like, I don't know, it's not like, as I said before, like it's not just the spectacle that informs, you know, our conditioning, but like people around you reinforcing it because
every
like
day.
they're in the same vacuum.
Yeah.
And so we go from the siren and like the fourth act, so to speak, although like the show is so like way more expansive than that, but the fourth act is performed by Kim, who plays the role of Marinette. Marinette is a voodoo.
Marinette is meaning puppet, right? The French word is puppet, but
no, that's marionette.
Oh, marionette is okay.
Like, yeah, her name is Marinette. Like,
okay.
And
she's a Haitian divinity.
She's and she is understood to have existed like on the island of Hispaniola. She is said to have slaughtered a black pig. She's like a voodoo priestess, a mambo.
So if I could just to say that I know that there's some divinities that come into existence in these religions that actually are real people. And after they've died, they could have been people in the 1940s. They become divinities in a religion, and this is one of them.
Absolutely. And I mean, the same can be said. I mean, I don't know all religions, but I know that, I mean, the Catholic, I mean, they all do that. So, like, you know, there's this same system of sort of not heralding, what's the right word, like, whatever they name Mother
Teresa. Okay, yeah.
Canonizing people, exactly.
Yeah.
And so, like,
so Marinette
was a mambo, aka priestess,
yeah.
Who is said to have slaughtered a black pig as, I guess, like, there was something symbolic to it. I'm not well researched on it. But yeah, she slaughtered a black pig at the dawn of the Haitian Revolution, thus inspiring enslaved black Haitian people to revolt, and that resulted in Haiti becoming the first black republic. And so Marinette is known for her cruelty, for being vicious, and like she looks out for the oppressed, for her own people. And so like him had like, you know, all these ideas around like, you know, fending off like, you know, white tears, white femininity.
Sending off white tears.
Yeah, white tears, white fragility, white femininity.
She doesn't want to deal with it.
She doesn't want to deal. Yeah, she slaves.
She's
it.
Slaying white fragility.
Yeah, but it can be like a number of things. Like, you know, like you'd have to have a conversation with him, and I have my take on it. But like, it's whatever, like whatever oppressive force that you want to slay. And so if I have a bone to pick with like, you know, straight men, you know. It could be said that, like, oh, I'm serving, like, Marinette, you know, against, you know, someone even specific. It doesn't even have to be. So that's usually why a Marinette is summoned. And I thought it was, I don't know, it was, like, a nice addition to like, the range of themes that the show encompasses.
So it's, I mean, obviously we haven't given everything away, but what's great is that you don't just have these archetypes, which to me are the anchors in a way. And, you know, I was like thinking architectural terms, so it's almost like you have a car or four wheels, and you have these archetypes, these anchors at all the ends. But then it's expansive because outside of those archetypes, you have these pop cultural characters who I wouldn't say embody that, but also that are great examples of Black thinker, actors, people who have been able to transgress the spectacle, to look at it in its eye. And when I look at Kim, often when she's doing her piece, like, she has this crazy look in her eye, but she's looking right back at the spectacle. And I have to say, when I look at Josephine Baker and what she does with her eyes, I swear to God, I really feel she knows what she's doing in those moments. Mm-hmm. I feel like, and that, I love what I've seen of the piece so far, because I feel like you're actually, there's the return of the games, you know, in the 90s, you know, I'm an OG in the cultural studies world. And part of the first post-colonial studies and cultural studies, and we used to talk about the return of the gaze. Uh-huh. And I feel like I'm seeing that a lot of what they're presenting.
I think that, thanks for saying that, and I think that, you know, the context is good for us to be having those conversations, because, of course, someone of Josephine Baker's, you know, fame and notoriety wouldn't be so transgressive as saying that, like, they're you know, putting the mirror up, you know, like people's, like, for the gaze to see itself.
Oh, interesting.
Because it would, I mean,
you're saying she's putting the mirror up.
I don't think so. Done more subtly. It's definitely done more subtly, or at least she can't have, you know, a clear, open conversation, and, like, for, like, those types of, like, you know, mainstream performances.
At that time, she couldn't do that.
At that time, and even in the present day, like, I don't know if there's anyone, you know, of that, you know, whose popularity is of that magnitude that is able to do that without losing money, in essence. Mm. And so, like, the context that we find ourselves in with Naibogo is one that serves, you know, performance art, dance, where the audience is interested in being pushed on an intellectual and on a discursive level, and accepts confrontation in a way that, like, your regular, you know, mainstream culture consumer is not willing.
I think one of the things also, and it's a worded idea that a lot of people aren't aware of, it's the idea of the trickster. And I think this is one of the things I write about, and I'm working a lot about with one Indigenous dancer I'm writing with now a Sri Lankan, Rajik Guerra, Mepsidu, Sri Lankan painter, and an Indian painter. This figure of the trickster, right? And this is something that has followed us as people in diaspora. These are people that have existed in the past and exist now. And when I think about in the contemporary moment, I'm thinking even at the beginning of rock and roll, Sister Rosetta Tharpe.
Yeah.
When you see her playing on the train tracks and the white people on the other side watching her, there's so much transgression happening. Uh-huh. Then you have Little Richard, and it keeps going. And, like, we continuously have these figures, and I swear to God, I think I want to put Cardi B there as one of these people. You know, as crazy as Cardi is, there's a little bit of trickster going on there.
I mean, there's a bit of trickster, but, you know, what I want to say is has to do with how the message is perceived rather than what the you know, performer's intention, person's intention is.
Yes.
You know, there's you know, been an uproar following comments that a rapper named Da Baby made, like, some, like, xerophobic, homophobic, misogynistic remarks made at a show, and, like, you know, all of a sudden, like, on social media, like, people, like, jumped on the bandwagon, and everyone had something to say, and, you know, people were hashtagging it, and, like, not only can you think of that, of people making those, like, micro commentaries as a way to, like, you know, be in on the conversation and, like, reap, you know, the benefits, like, the exposure and, like, you know, applause from it. But also, like, what's the baby saying, even if he's a trickster, I mean, it's clear to me that you know, there's powers in place that want to elevate Black men that perform in a way that is conducive to like white and non-Black people's satisfaction, like how they want to view Black people as being savage, as being hyper-violent, homophobic, etc. When like, you know, arranged, like there's like so many Black artists out there who actually want to like, you know, to have conversations with their audience that is, I don't know, less like perhaps less meta, just like more direct.
Yeah, I mean, again, it comes back to what you said, being conditioned to perform, you know.
Yeah.
And so it's from the beginning of the century with the Venus Hottentot. Uh-huh. That's before this century, isn't it? The Venus Hottentot brought from Africa, put on display with her booty for everybody to come around and look at her in a cage. And there is this conditioning to perform. But, you know, I feel like when I'm looking at some of your work, like Ali Bobo, and looking at, you know, the, just, you know, your latest TV special, with Sony for Buffalo, I do think there is, we're in a moment where we can find a little fold inside of the celluloid. But yes, we're ultimately inside of this industrial complex.
Yeah, and I don't pretend to be isolated from it. I mean, you know, the way that the way that I present, you know, tries in many ways to align with, you know, standards of like femininity or Black femininity that are like perceived to be like more palatable because like, you know, they're understood as like being like more feminine or like prettier. And so like, I don't absolve myself from sin, from that kind of sin.
But I think it's that kind of honesty. I think it's that kind of honesty that can sort of create projects where people don't feel like there's just two options, you know, the selling out option and the like being this like quote unquote social justice warrior / cultural artist who's being subversive. I think we can be smart and find some rails in between them to do that, because we have examples like, I don't know if you're a fan, but you know, like Blood Orange, Devante Hines, the fact that they just did this TV show, did you see it? It's incredible, by Luca Guadagnino. I think it's called We Are Here, Where We Are Here. And they actually got a TV show with my friend Tim Sevigny on it. And it was about a non-binary kid. He didn't know what he was up to, and living on a military base in the U.S. So I think we're at a stage where we can start creating these projects, you know?
I mean, for sure. And like, we've always been able, like, you know, transgression has always existed. And, yeah, I didn't know about that show. I love me some Blood Orange. I think he's a great songwriter.
I met him in person.
Oh, okay. what was I going to say? Yeah, like, it's great. At the same time, I feel like I have ideas around like the constant influx of like information, like about, and also with like things either being not curated enough or like too niche, like the internet, you know, having so many niches that like you can't like, it's become harder to collectively gather around you know, like it's not consensus, but like, yeah, it's less of a monoculture. And so as much as like you push the envelope, it might be more difficult to influence for the better other people, unless you have a lot of money. That's to me what dictates you know, the standards of internet influence and popularity.
Well, I mean, I think we're gonna maybe take some questions.
Are we going to take questions?
But, you know, what I would say to add to that is the title, which for me, I love. And to me, it says a lot. Because for me, when I think of diaspora, and obviously diasporas are groups of people that are dispersed, right? But they're also about those people, as you have written, the title is Dissecting the Realities of the Interwoven.
I don't remember what I
said. But this whole idea of interweaving those dissecting realities, right?
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
To me, that's what's key now. Right? Uh-huh. That's the kind of, like, I studied with a French poet, and he talked about always, like, this tissement, the tisser des choses, to sew them back together. And that's what's nice with the piece, because when I saw it, there's this squadron, there's a web, and the web is what's important. But what's most important, which you represent, is the womb. And the womb is where there can be this kind of, like, inside and outside. And I think we're at a stage like that. I don't hold you in less esteem than somebody like Blood Orange. I've been listening to your music before. You thought I would. No, I was. So people like yourself, Blood Orange, you are creating this, you are working within this womb that we're trying to, like, maintain, and this sort of, like, this interweaving. So when we're talking about this monoculture, about collectively gathering, this is what you're doing. It's important. People should see the work. It's good.
Thanks for saying that. I hope that, I mean, we still have a lot of work to do on the show. I hope that it's on par with my standards, and I'm sure it will, because there's just no other way. But yeah, come see the show. It's such a labor of love, and, you know, my two daughters, as well as the two guests from other houses in Montreal, are insanely talented, and we've got lots to offer. So Cyan Barbara, Chris Marlowe Barbara, Kim Ninkoru Sankofa, and Ronnie Figueroa Campbell are the four performers. And it's really come to that point. Like, there's a lot of talk around, like, you know, representation, and also a lot of pushback. And in Quebec, I find there's, like, a lot of pushback against people who say they want to be visually and audibly represented, when, I mean, the irony is, like, just a few months ago, I was reading just, like, a bunch of columns in, like, Francophone media complaining that there weren't Francophone hockey players in the Canadiens team. And so, you know, that, like, directly ties into, like, you know, what we're arguing is that, like, we want to be represented in order to feel empowered in our, you know, micro collective identities. And so I think that, you know, it's great that something like Aiba was happening in the ballroom, and, like, I'm sure a bunch of, like, artists, like, people whom I might not know that work in Montreal and in Canada and in Quebec feeling affirmed in their intersectional Black, gay, trans, lesbian Blackness. We hardly see that, and Blackness is often presented as such a monolith that it's important to have those. I hate using the word intersectional all the time, but I can't resist.
Anyway. But it's the weaving.
Yeah.
It's the what you're talking about. Weaving all the realities.
Yeah.